Nigeria's 13 trillion budget has been presented by President Muhammadu Buhari. Tonight, we are looking into the budget. This is Plus Politics. I am Kayode Ladeinde. Welcome back. It's time to talk business. And this time around, we're going to look at figures this time around. So President Muhammadu Buhari presented a 13.08 trillion 2021 budget estimate to the National Assembly. The proposed expenditure was arrived at with a crude oil benchmark price of $40 per barrel and daily oil production estimate at 1.86 million barrels. The budget also includes 1.35 trillion spending by government-owned enterprises and grants and aids, funded expenditure of 354.85 billion naira. Also, a projected inflation rate of 11.95% and GDP growth of 3.00% was considered. Joining us to discuss this is definitely a financial analyst, Mukhtar Mohammed. Good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, just to remind you that this is Plus Politics, but we are discussing money, we are discussing figures, we are discussing issues that keep the polity going. So let's look at the budget. Earlier today, you were on our news bulletin, where you did a whole lot of assumptions, but this time around, the budget has been unveiled. We can see what is inside, and the process will start in earnest. So let's look at it from the angle. What's your general assessment of the budget presented?
Kayode, like you said, I did a lot of assumptions, but at least I got one very right. I think if I was to name it, I'll name it a budget of recovery. And I think maybe the federal government were listening to me. They named it a budget of economic recovery and resilience. And I think it's good. Okay, when you look at this budget, there's a lot of good things in the budget, but you need to look at three areas that Nigerians have been concerned all the while. One of those concerns that Nigerians have raised is in the area of debt. And secondly, for me, you remember this morning I talked about the benchmark at $40 per barrel. And those, when you look at the total revenue that we're expecting, about 7 point something trillion, and then you look at a debt profile, debts that we're going to pay this year is going to be about 3.12 trillion, and that is almost 50% of our revenue be going to service debt. Then on with that, the president even made it categorically clear today that we will still be borrowing about 4 point something trillion. So the borrowing game has not stopped, the debt game has not stopped. So when you look at all these buy, but you need to give it to them. When you look at some of the increment that we have in the health sector, you remember today in your morning program, I said that it will be catastrophic for the government not to increase the health sector. And I saw the list, maybe they did listen, and that place was increased by about 157%. Also, the educational sector, remember I said about it also, was also increased by 35%. And the good thing about the educational sector is the science and technical schools that will be established in over 5 new science and technical schools. I think that is good. And you remember you talked about businesses. How do I expect the government to do about business? I said I expect them to do direct intervention by and by what we have before. And I think they are doing the same thing that they said they would do. I mean, that I thought they should do. And that is the pandemic intervention is still ongoing. And yet, government will still be looking at ways to help other small businesses so that they will not go under. So the budget looked good on paper, with just the concern in the area of debt to revenue. And debt to GDP is okay, but debt to revenue is a big challenge. I think that's what I see about this present budget.
Okay, listening to the president, he highlighted something quite interesting, which I think politicians will very soon jump on. We are waiting for some of their comments. But in interim, if you look at, he said they have about 7 trillion out of the 13 trillion to fund the budget. So, and they said they will borrow 4 trillion. And he said we should take note of the grants And for a lot of people who probably don't understand why the president should take pleasure in the fact that, oh, this thing is not about full borrowing, it's a grant that we use in funding this budget. To what significance is that?
Well, grants or borrowing, it depends on how you look at it and what those agreements are. You know, sometimes in Nigeria, a lot of things is trade in secrecy. Before you know it, the grant becomes borrowing. So we need to know what those grants are. Nobody just gives you free grants like that. There must be some condition attached to it. So for me, I'm not excited yet until I see where these grants are coming from and what these grants are going to do. As far as I'm concerned, I know that 4.something trillion will be borrowed, whether they are going to be grant of, even if you look at the grant, he was talking about grant of 700 and something billion and others. So I am not thinking like him. I'm not excited like him. I'm not taking note like him. I'm only taking note of the borrowing, and that's what I'm interested in.
Okay, and obviously the grants should be used for infrastructure. But let's look at the political part of it, where the president had to even increase the budget of the National Assembly from by 3 billion, from that's from 125 billion to 128 billion. People would say, probably this might prevent that evil that we always encounter, that controversy of budget padding. Do you think this will in any way assuage the National Assembly to get straight to business and get this bill sorted out by December?
Budget padding, giving the National Assembly 128 billion in terms of statutory allocation. Niger Delta having about 50-something billion, the cash cow of the country. Northeast development, education, even having lesser budget than the National Assembly. And then you come in, you tell people that it's time for us to tire bed, it's time for us to reduce expenditure. Look at the recurrent expenditure in that budget, about 5.something trillion. And the more part of the recurrent expenditure is what you give to the National Assembly. For me, it is it's not good enough. It shows that the government that is not going with the times. Because the times that we are now are times where people are looking at costing the cost of governance and using that money to begin to have impact on the people, especially after the advent of COVID. So for a government to still be thinking of giving the National Assembly 128 billion, it being larger than what you give to Universal Basic Education Commission, it's called for concern and for worry. So it really shows that Nigerian budget has gone political. And I think the president is now beginning to play the budget the way, play the politics the way he thinks he wants to play the politics. Remember, this is the National Assembly also, that is the leader of the National Assembly, which is the Senate president, said, whatever the president brings to the table will be passed. And I believe strongly that this budget will just go through the normal ritual and it will be passed even before December 31st. I jokingly told someone, I said there will be a budget presentation. I said, what do you mean a budget present? He said, it will be estimated, but I said the budget will be passed because that's what the Senate has made us to believe, that anything that comes from the president will not go through rigorous scrutiny.
Okay, that's a worrisome issue that you've just raised there. But let's look at it technically. This issue will continue to be on the front burner. As far as we are concerned, that talks about the cost of governance. Attention so much on the National Assembly, but if time will permit us, we'll also find a way of reviewing the extra codes of the executive arm of government. But still on the National Assembly, can we ever achieve a reduction in their allowances? How do we get to fix that? They seem to be ironically helpless because they said they didn't fix their pay, they didn't fix their allowance. So does it have to go through the Act of Parliament, or what should be done?
You see, it is when it favored them, you hear them say things like, we didn't fix it, we are not part of it, it's the national, it's going to go through constitution. But once it doesn't favor them, they have a way of bringing it to doctrine of necessity, and then they would know what to do about it. How do we even begin to cut an estimate or allowance, like you just rightly pointed out, when we don't even know what the allowances are? Because up to this moment, the National Assembly allowances and paid are still showing secrecy. Until recently, we don't still know how much a senator, a member of the House of Representatives take home every month. So it's still in a lot of secrecy. And now here they are telling us that, look, we didn't fix it. We met it like that. But again, if they are really sincere, it just takes a doctrine of necessity to reverse that. We've seen them do it in a lot of things when it involved them. But with this, that has to do with their own pocket, and they'll tell you they spend so much money during the electoral campaign, and they think the National Assembly is a place, or where you are a senator or a member of the rep, is where you recoup some of this money that you think you used during your election period.
Okay, so let's also look at some of these indices. We're looking at 1.8 million barrels per day, and at the rate of $40 per barrel. And people would say, is this assumption too ambitious? You know, looking at the last one as we speak, in 2020, it was $28. $40, is it that they are being moderate, or they are actually even underestimating what is possible?
You see, the same mistake that was made in 2020 is the same mistake we are making here today. The day the president presented the budget in 2020, he put the benchmark of crude at $60 per barrel. That very day, before the end of the day of the presentation, the price of crude went as low as $58 per barrel. Now, today, we are putting that at $40 per barrel, and the price of crude is hovering between $40, $38, $39, and $41 per barrel. So it's more or less like we've not learned any lesson. And then if you look at the revenue that will be accruing, like you said about whether one point something is very ambitious, look at the revenue. The revenue is about 40% of our revenue will be coming from the oil sector, about $2.01 trillion. So when you look at that vast, the OPEC quota, which has been pegged at 1.8, and remember that if price of crude goes down, then we may have to go back, whereby OPEC will be telling them member nations to cut down their production level. If that happens, then the budget is a budget that is already challenging becomes more challenging. So for me, I think it's an over ambitious plan, especially Brent crude at $40 per barrel is over ambitious. I think they should do better by bringing it as low as 30 to 35 dollars per barrel, so that we know that we are safe. We know we are working with what we have. That would be good than what we are having now.
Because I'm also looking at the fact that it's an assumption. It's a budget, and if you look at what the deadly blow the pandemic, you know, hard on us as a nation or even the global economies, I think things are picking up. So do you really think 40 is on the high side?
The things are picking up, but remember, it's just more or less like when you have a goods flow, they will say there's backlog. So you still see when an accident happened and there was traffic jam, they will tell you that incident has been cleared, but there's still backlog. It's what we are trying to clear. So even if you take the economy is moving up, there's still backlog of a lot of issues. Backlog of debt, backlog of unemployment, backlog of not every company is going to come to work this year. Definitely, whether you like it or not, the consuming power of Nigerians are going down. Cost of living is going up. Nigerians pay high for everything. So for me, I don't think they are being very realistic when it comes to dealing with the Nigerian people. They need to come to our level. They need to begin to see how we can begin to grow this economy from bottom, taking it up, rather from looking at the up, bringing it down. It has not done any economy good. When you forget the bottom pill, like I said this morning, today we have a report that 78 million Nigerians are not just poor, they are extremely poor.
That's a serious issue, and that's where I'm actually going. We want to speak the language of the man on the street. We want to speak the language of what are they even talking about. So how does this translate to them? The presidency has explained that this is going to be a job creation and economic stability. Two critical points. And let's look at it. Let's not just look at who are the people that will perform this budget? Job creation. How visible is that? Because when we remember the project of 20,000 naira monthly for 3 months, and my question is, I hope that's not what they meant by job creation. But they've mentioned that when we have massive infrastructure, there's going to be jobs all around. So should we see these capital projects as something that we should leverage on?
Currently, jobs are divided into about two. You have the skill and the unskilled. That is one. So when you talk about construction side, the Chinese are not even, they are bringing up the skill. The Nigerians are just the unskilled. So after they finish that project, what happens? Then we are left to bring back the Chinese to keep managing this project, even if we have done the concession and the concession period is over. So when the government is talking about creating jobs, the job, when you talk about construction side job, you are talking of jobs that you're giving to just a few people that comes in there in the morning to work. You are not talking about the skilled people. How many graduates want to be doing a constructing job if it's not, if they are not the like working like a QS? How many of those jobs are QS jobs? How many of those jobs, engineering jobs, that Nigerians, engineers that will be passing out will have? Basically, it's the unskilled job they will give to us. Even most of the construction works we are seeing all around Lagos, it's both basically the unskilled. So for me, I don't think that when you look at in the infrastructure, good, you could give it to this government. This is the government that have done so much when it comes to infrastructure. But they shouldn't use that to say that is the way they want to create jobs. Jobs are not created by government. Government provide the enabling environment so that the private sector will tap into that, and by that, jobs are created and government earn revenue to build infrastructure. But what the way we do it is that government in Nigeria and especially in Africa become the largest employer of labor. You can't grow an economy like that. You can never grow an economy where government is the largest employer of labor. So if government is thinking, we are the one that we're going to employ, we are the one that, like you said, the 774 lucky government will be having 20,000. Just today also I heard that the World Bank is partnering with the federal government in cash distribution to the next valuable, but that will also be guided with data. So you don't throw money. Throwing money at the problem will not solve the problem. You need to look at the root cause of those problems. What has happened to the trader money? We threw money for traders. But what has happened to it? So we should learn from the mistake we have made so that we can go forward.
Okay, because I'm still talking about this. I listen to government too. We always listen to all sides. And I remember attending one of the flag-offs of some of these rail projects. And while they were making this explanation, they said, if we have these rail lines functioning, there will be some people selling tickets. There will be some people managing different stations. And I'm aware that you've been to different parts of the world. It's usually a massive activities going on in that area. So, but our worry is, how do we also have the same process? Because each time we frown at the way they are borrowing, you are like, that's what borrowing is meant to attend to, the issue of infrastructure. So can we see that picture here?
Kari, I agree with you totally. Remember, if there's anybody that's I've always thought that this government has borrowed well, I'm the one. I think they borrowed very well. I still emphasize it this morning, and I still believe that this government has borrowed very well. Their borrowing is very strategic. Their borrowing is very, it's good borrowing, because they are borrowing to build infrastructures, and these infrastructures in turn will be going to concessional level, whereby this entire will be able to generate money in the long term and will be able to pay off some of those debts. So for me, I'm okay with that. I think they borrowed well, especially when you talked about the rail project. Now, the rail project is a massive project. If you look at development in every part of the world, in the 1870s, 1880s, something that United States became what they were, it was virtually from the rail project. It's better trying to link people for businesses, convenient. So we are getting that right, even if we are getting it right a little bit late. We can say we are getting it right because we are beginning to see rail. That's one of the oldest means of transportation, and that still remains one of the best means of transportation, especially when we have to do with a set of goods and services. And with a country that have bad road and we have security challenges, then the rail project is a good thing for us. So for me, I'm happy with that. Yes, they'll create a lot of jobs. definitely the woman that will sell in the street, inside of every of those terminals, the man that will sell tickets. There are other businesses that will come up, the people that will be repairing the rail line thing. So for me, yes, but when will this project take effect? They're saying before the end of this Remember that we're looking at the Ibadan electric to have kickstart. Say the minister came and said the pandemic will move it to October, but today the minister is telling us that we may not have it in December. So, is that the prelude on this? And so, we're talking of data. If you're talking, you're going to create job for it. How much of this we have in terms of data? How many jobs are you going to create? How is this job going to benefit the economy? So, you don't just say, "Oh, I'm creating job because I'm building infrastructure." They must be matched with specifics.
Okay, still talking about that, because like we said, let's look at what really happened to the budget performance of 2020. A very clear factor is the issue of the pandemic. And, you know, the president mentioned something that I consider quite controversial. He said economics performed better than most economies in developed economies, and he mentioned the fact that if you talk about the UK, you talk about the America. He didn't mention those names, but we know those are the developed economies. So, what did we do right? Were we just lucky? Did we save enough, or what exactly worked well for us that we can, you know, take a cue from?
And then what worked for us is that God is in Nigeria. There's nothing we did anything different. In this economy, when you are comparing yourself with the United Kingdom, you're comparing yourself with the US. Look at the United States economy. You remember every citizen of the United Kingdom was giving cash transfer in these times, like this. Every taxpayer in the United States there was an intervention from government. The same thing with the United Kingdom. So when the president is saying that,
if I don't even go to Canada,
they can give you because they have the data. So they have data to back up these plans that they are saying. You are saying that they come. What? How? What is it through the intervention they did, or what happened? They say, it's always very difficult when we see our government comparing ourselves. Sometimes they compare with Saudi Arabia in the area of food price. It's not because you are growing your GDP. Your GDP was negative last year. You are celebrating it because it's not as negative as United Kingdom, as the United States. Why don't you look at that GDP again, via infrastructure, via population? That's when you clap yourself. You can't be saying that you have a population of about 200 million and 78 million of those people are extremely poor, and you are saying our economy is doing very well. I don't think that is fair.
Okay, speaking the language of the man on the street, now two things are on their minds, the issue of the fuel and the issue of the electricity tariff, which you're a bit confused about, whether it's going to expire in 2 weeks, the enjoyment that we are given. And people are saying that it's like the minimum wage was not worth it again. And when we talk about the minimum wage, how many states are even faithful? How many states have been paying it consistently? So how does the man on the street, you know, come to terms with this budget?
Unfortunately, the man on the street may have to suffer more by this budget, if you look at this budget the way it is, because no provision has been made for the man on the street from revive this budget. The only provision has been made for the man on the street is that we'll be doing infrastructural development. You go there and work and you have a job. I think that's, for me, that's the only big thing. Because like you pointed out, some states have not been able to pay this. The cost of electricity is definitely going to go high. In 2 weeks' time, by Monday, now I'm sure the discos will be very excited to go back to their rate or whatever agreed rate they were. Within 24 hours, you see the change in that rate. They will not need a letter from the regulators to do that. But when it comes to reduction, they will need a letter from the regulator. And the president made a very good point, which I agree with. He said the interest of the subsidy, petroleum subsidy, has gone, and those money will be channeled. I think that's the best gift this president administration has given to us, if they are able to keep up to that. So when up to the man on the street, it doesn't make any sense, because the man on the street, like the vice president said 2 days ago, is to have food on his table. And so as long as you cannot provide food for him, then it's not doing well. And as far as this budget is concerned, this budget is not going to provide food for the Nigerian man in the short term. Neither do I see providing food for them in the long term, in terms of a food in the short term, just hand to mouth in the long term to live better, get good job. I don't see it in this budget for the ordinary Nigerian. What we've seen about this budget is that they are trying to build infrastructure. They are trying to see how we can move our economy forward based on via building infrastructure. But remember what the slogan that comes in before. They call it stomach infrastructure. So the government themselves are more interested in stomach. The people, I mean, the ordinary people in Nigeria, the poor, the downtrodden, say, look, they say they need stomach infrastructure. They don't need all this capital infrastructure. So for the other man, it's what will I eat today. So for me, I'm still neither here nor there.
Now, that would take me to two questions in one, and I would prefer you answer the two questions while responding. Now, the recent statistics from Nigerian Bureau of Statistics, that's the NBS, shows that 68% of Nigerians were hungry in August. And the issue of food security has to do with they had to borrow to eat in August. That was still one of those top moments of the COVID. And the question is, what has our diversification into agriculture, what has it done for us? Because we hear government say they've achieved full potential in terms of food security. How do we juxtapose these statistics and our quest to diversify into agriculture? Okay, I understand the network is misbehaving. We are going to stay with you. We'll take a short break. There are still more issues we need to deal with. Please don't go anywhere. We'll be back soon.